Welcome back. In this video, we are going to talk about artillery bombardments. One of the first things we have to discuss is who can actually shoot an artillery bombardment. And the best way to find out is to go to your arsenal. So I'm going to move the camera down to an arsenal in this book. And I went to gun teams. So looking over here, looking down. Oh, firing bombardment tells me right there. Firing bombardment. So if we go back up to like this M5 3-inch gun late, there's no bombardment listed, so it can't do that. However, this M2A1 105mm howitzer can fire bombardments. So that's how you tell who can and who cannot shoot bombardments. So since we're looking at this book anyway, let's understand a little bit about what's going on here. So if we follow this, let's do the 155s. So here's the 155, 24-inch shot. You're probably going, that kind of sucks because a tank can do, 32 inches. Well, yeah, that does kind of, it's not as good range. It gets one die, anti-tank 10. Ooh, 1+ firepower though. That's pretty good. It's a bunker buster. It's got gun shield and smoke. It can shoot direct fire smoke, which we will talk about smoke in this video. But there's a second line down here. It says firing bombardments. 88 inches. So now, that's a big difference between just the 32-inch for a tank, for most tanks. It's got a 24-inch straight shot, kind of like a rifle, tank shot, or something like that. Gun team shot. However, if it wants to do that artillery bombardment, it can do it 88 inches away. Dash. Rate of fire. Dash. Wait, it gets no dice? Well, it will get dice, but every artillery is going to have the same thing. They all are going to have these dashes on it. Because artillery's done a little different. I shouldn't say a little, it's done pretty much a lot different than your regular shooting will be. So it's got a dash. Then if we continue on, anti-tank 5. Now you're going, oh wait, that's even worse than that 10. I mean, that 10 is like a Sherman. That's, it's okay. A 5? Oh my gosh, why would I ever do artillery bombardment? Well, what you got to understand about artillery bombardment is it's shot way up in the air, it arcs, and it comes down on top of the target. So what you're actually doing is hitting the top armor of a tank, which generally is 1. So a 5's not looking too bad now, because if they have just a 1, they're going to add 1 to their die roll. Alright, so they've done that. Let's see, 2+ firepower. Wow, that's pretty good. Tank has a 3, this has a 2+. And smoke bombardment. What that means is, either it can shoot to damage, or it can shoot to do smoke. It can't do both on that bombardment. And I'll get into smoke bombardment in this video. So that's how you can tell who can and who cannot shoot an artillery bombardment. Let me get this set up here. Okay, now, actually, I want to go a little bit more into who, because there's a few more things you have to keep track of. Also, if they want to do an artillery bombardment, they cannot move. So in this case, I got these priests here, which can do artillery bombardment. If they move on the movement step, on the shooting step, they cannot shoot their artillery bombardment. Now, let's say this one moves, but they don't. They can do the artillery bombardment. He cannot. So if you move, you can't do an artillery bombardment. You can unlimber if you're being like towed. If your artillery piece is being towed and you unlimber, you're allowed to unlimber in that movement step, then you still can fire your artillery bombardment, and you rotate to face the target, of course. If you are pinned, if the artillery that's doing the bombardment is pinned, it cannot shoot the artillery bombardment. Now, just remember, armored vehicles ignore that pin. So, pinned or not, they don't get pinned, but pinned or not, they can still shoot their artillery bombardment. They can still shoot their artillery bombardment because they're an armored vehicle. But, like this gun team over here, can't do it. If they're pinned, they cannot do the artillery bombardment. They can still do their straight shot, that like that 24-inch shot, they can still do that. They just can't do the artillery bombardment. So, we know now, if they have the arsenal, which is the arsenal told us that they can do it, they're able to shoot the artillery bombardment, just can't move. But you could have unlimbered, and you cannot be pinned down unless you're armored vehicle. All right, so when can you shoot artillery? Well, it's in the shooting step. And basically, you can do it anytime you want in the shooting step. Just think of it as another tank, as another rifle team, anything like that. So it could be that I'm going to move this down here. It could be that I decided that I want to shoot my rifles. Then I want to shoot this artillery. Then I shoot that artillery. Then I shoot machine gun and I shoot mortars. Then I shoot this artillery. It's just like, who do you want to have shooting at that time? It's like, is this the perfect time for the artillery to shoot? Then shoot with it. If it's not, wait. Now, there is one stipulation. Remember in the arsenal it said smoke bombardment? If you're going to shoot smoke bombardment, it has to be the very first shot you take in a shooting step. If you shoot anything else, you can't do smoke bombardment that shooting step. You have to wait till your next shooting step. So if you want to do smoke bombardment, that has to be the first thing you shoot in the shooting step. Each team, just like normal, when you're shooting, once they're done shooting, they're done. Once these guys are done doing an artillery bombardment, they're done for that step. They can't do a second artillery bombardment in that step. There was also that rule, like, you know, these guys, tanks are moving up. This one wants to shoot this tank. This one wants to shoot this tank. This one wants to shoot the infantry. And they could do that. If you're doing artillery bombardment, all of those in that platoon participating in artillery bombardment has to shoot the same target. So this one can't do an artillery bombardment this direction, and this one over here, and then this one over here. If this one decides one to do artillery bombardment this way, they all are doing it at the same target. So artillery bombardment does have that limitation. You can't split it up. Also, if this shoots its artillery bombardment, this one either has to join that artillery bombardment or do no shooting at all. Same with this one. So those that can do artillery bombardment, if one in the team is going to do it, either they have to join in or they do no shooting whatsoever. Now there is an exception to this, and what I'm going to do is I'm going to pull this over here and we can look at this platoon. So we're looking at this, these 155s. So we got a 155, 155, 155, and 155. So we got four of them. We got an observer. We got a staff team. It kind of looks like this with a little table. This is going to be very important during bombardments. And then our company, the platoon commander. Not company commander, but the platoon commander. Now, remember I said if they shoot, they don't get to do any other shooting. That applies to those that only, that can do the artillery. They can't do artillery bombardments. These are the ones doing the artillery bombardment. They don't. They're not limited to that. So if they do their artillery bombardment, these guys can still shoot as riflemen. So just keep that in mind. Now, how to spot for artillery. Okay, who can do it? All right. Well, of course, their observer, for this platoon can do it. Now, one of the things is, he spots for this platoon. He was purchased with this platoon. He spots for this platoon only. Now, there is a rule that he can spot for other teams. We're not going to worry about that right now. Just, he's spotting for them. It's their observer. Staff team can spot. The platoon commander can spot. Any one of them can spot for the artillery shot. Now, there are some other people that can spot. One of them is your company commander can spot. And if you have a higher commander team, they can spot. However, these guys have had a lot of training how to spot and how to range in and stuff with their weapon. The company commander and the higher command team haven't had that much training. They've had some, so they can kind of help you, but they haven't had as much. So there is a +1 penalty to hit your target when you use your company commander or your higher command team. So just remember, you can use those two, but they're not as good, so there's gonna be a slight penalty. Now, there are some specialist observer teams, such as an air observer post, and I'll get to that. It's an airplane that runs around. It can observe for any platoon. Well, not any platoon. It can observe for a platoon. Now, you can only have one spotter spot per platoon. I don't know why that's kind of in there, because I don't know why you would have two spotters spotting for... I mean, you can have two spotters. There are some... like some Germans that have like two spotters in one platoon. Just basically pick a spotter for the platoon that's able to spot for them and then use that one. And that spotter can only spot for that one team. He can't spot for that team and then spot for another team on that same shooting step. Now also, your spotter could not have moved, cannot shoot, cannot assault. Basically, your whole turn, all they're doing is observing and calling in the artillery shot. That's all they're doing. Also, they must have line of sight, and I've talked about line of sight, so the observer must have line of sight to the target, and the target's gonna be what's called the aiming point. So they must have a line of sight to the aiming point. They can be pinned and spot. Remember, if the artillery is pinned, they can't shoot. But an observer, if they're pinned, can still spot. However, if it's a vehicle that's bailed out or bogged down, they cannot do any spotting. Now, there is a way that this observer, and I'm going to move this up. So we've got these long toms in here. There is a way that this observer could spot for them. Normally, he can't do that. He's bought with this platoon. He's used for this platoon only. He cannot spot for any other platoon. The way to get around that is staff team. And these guys are going to be, like I said, are going to become very important during the during this artillery. This is where they really shine. So to be able to use him to spot for them, because let's say... magically, some big old mountain came in the way and they can't see over that mountain, but this guy's up on the hill and he can see over that mountain or this hill. They can't. They're right up here. They can't see. Their vision's totally blocked, but he can spot. How they can use him is if the platoon he's in has a staff team and the platoon that wants to use him has a staff team. Then he can spot for them and call in a shot for them. However, if he does that, he cannot be used for them. Remember, he can only spot for one platoon per shooting step. So that's how you can get around to where the spotter can spot for other teams. All right, now, let's talk a little bit more about the observers. They are independent teams. I talked about independent teams. So they don't even have to be here with this platoon. I put them here for purposes of explanation. However, You know what? He wants to be in this building over here. Well, he can do that. If this is in your deployment zone, well, he can get there. But let's say this is in my deployment zone. It's beginning the game, and we put all this stuff down. Now it's time to put warriors and independent teams. This is an independent team. We go, you know what? He's in this building. Well, wait, he's out of complete command from these guys way over here. He's way over there. I mean, that's how far away is that from this group? He's about 18 inches away from them. Excuse me. That is way out of command. Well, it's an independent team. They can run off by themselves like warriors can. So he does not have to be in command with them. He wants to get where he has a good sight. He wants to possibly get up high, like an awesome place for an observer to be in this game. It'd be up in that bell tower, like looking out that window there, observing, looking over the battlefield, because think about all the things he can see over and all the terrain he can see over that's not going to interfere with his line of sight to see a target to call in that artillery. He could also have him moved up and then go in there. But remember, if they move, they can't do an observation. They can't call in the artillery bombardment. All right, so go back down to them. Okay, so he's an independent team. He normally can only spot for his team, but there's a way he can spot for other teams. We just talked about that. They also have what's called cautious movement. And you're like, well, what in the world is cautious movement? Well, reconnaissance also has this cautious movement. So if you buy a reconnaissance team, they have the same thing as the observers have. And what, I'll tell you what cautious movement is. They are always gone to ground, unless they moved it double. Carry, or if they're transport, a carry passenger, and a non-reconnaissance team, that has more to do with reconnaissance. But I'm just reading the rules as they're written. Always gone to ground unless they move at the double. They carry passengers that are not reconnaissance teams. They shoot or assault. So basically, with the observer team, the thing is, if they move at the double, if they shoot or they assault, they lose that gone to ground. If they move, they normally, when you move, you lose. You don't have gone to ground. They get it when they move. So, as long as they don't shoot or stuff like that, they're always gone to ground. And we talked about the advantages of gone to ground, like too harder to hit you if you're concealed. Also, allocating hits out. We talked about that. All right. Now, if your observer is a tank team, and it could happen because I've got like these, here, I have these priests here. They actually have a tank as an observer for them. It's pretty cool. They get a tank. Gets to be an observer for them. Gets to move around and stuff like that. Now, there's a way you can dismount the observer out of that tank. The rules are, though, it cannot be bailed out. And if you want to do it, it has to be start of your movement step. So any movement step you have at the start of it, you can have them dismount out of that tank. Or at the start of the game, you can say, you know what? He's going to be out there. Yeah, I'm not going to use the tank. So what you do is you remove the tank and replace him with one of the with an observer base. So let's pretend like this is the observer tank. I know it's not, just pretend it's an observer tank. What I do is I take this off, remove it, and I get to put this observer down anywhere that his base was at. Now, if you don't have one of these, you can't do it. So you actually have to have the observer model to actually be able to do this. If you don't have the model, you can't do the replacing. Now, what I saw in the rules, it says it's removed. It didn't say sent to the rear. It said it is removed. So to me, that is saying that if you do this, that tank does not come back the rest of the game. Sending to the rear is you're able to use it later in the game if you want to. It said remove. So to me, it's taken out of the game. It's no longer, it can't be brought back. So if you decide to take your observer out of the tank, he's out of the tank for the rest of the game. All right, so that's our observer. Let's talk a little bit about our wonderful staff team. So I'm going to go back over here. And our wonderful staff team, which are around the table here, discussing tactics and where to shoot the artillery shots. So staff teams are considered infantry teams. So they move like infantry. Well, not quite. They have the same rules as infantry, 3+ save and all that. They shoot as rifles. So if you want them to shoot, they shoot as a rifle team. Their movement is basically 4 inches, no matter across country, on the road, difficult terrain, 4 inches. Where infantry goes 6, they only go 4. They're a little slower. I guess it takes a lot to carry that table around and the stools and stuff like that and then reset it back up. So they're a little bit slower than your infantry. Now, they can be in their own transport and still observe. So sometimes when you buy this, you can buy transports for them also. And then they can get in their transport, run around, get out, get in, run around, and stuff like that. It isn't like the replacing the tank with the observer. This one actually have a dedicated transport for them. If they're in their transport, not any other transport, but their transport, they can still observe from that transport. They don't have to be out of the transport. Now, the only time they can't observe when they're in their transport is if it's bogged down or bailed out. So you're hearing a lot of that bogged down, bailed out with spotters. Now, there is also one other special thing they allow. Not only do they allow, like, the other observer to be used with a different platoon for a bombardment, they have a special rule called all guns repeat. So if you have an artillery, I'm going to zoom back out here. So we've got this artillery here, platoon, with a staff team. They shoot and they ranged in on their target. And I will talk about ranging in. But they got their artillery shot to go where they wanted to. You put down this ranged in marker. So let's pretend we're looking down here. This is, they decide they're going to shoot at this platoon down here, or the, you know, and they hit this. They ranged in on this. Hitting's different than ranging in. They ranged in on this. We're going to put the ranged in marker, and I'm going to stick it up like this so it's easier to see on the camera. They ranged in on this. They're done doing all their shooting. Their turn's over. The opponent takes their turn. They do all their steps and everything. It's back to this player's turn. And they're now in the shooting step. They don't have to range in now. They automatically range in here because they had a staff team to help them keep those guns shooting in this spot. Now, there's one stipulation with the ranged in marker. If this moves, that doesn't move. That stays in that same spot. So if all these do like cockroaches and move away from there, you're out of luck then. So they do allow that all guns repeat, which is really, really nice. You don't have to do the ranging in again. No. And again, I'll get to what ranging in is, and you'll see why that is really nice. Now, there are a few stipulations with this ranging in marker as far as us putting it down. Okay, we got to put it down. That allows us to automatically range in on our first attempt, and I'll get to that, on this the same spot. However, you have to use the same spotter. So whoever was observing, whoever was spotting for that artillery bombardment, has to still be able to see that aiming point. Could not have moved, could not assault, and so forth. So they have to still be able to use that same observer. And all teams that participated in that bombardment have to participate in the all guns repeat bombardment if you want to be able to use that ability. So let me pull this back. So let's say these 155s shot, and they have a staff team, so we ranged in on the bad guys. Next turn, I want to be able to use this. The bad guys are still there, and I want to be able to do this ability. They're all going to have to shoot again. I can't have these long toms decide, you know what, you're ranged, hey, you know what, you guys were ranged in, I'm going to use your ranged in and hit them. Nuh-uh. Only those that originally shot at that spot get to use that ranged in. Now, there is ways you could do it. You can combine these two. Let's say these two combined into one big blast of artillery at those bad guys. Ranged in. Your turn's done. The opponent's gone through their turn. Done. It's now your turn again. They all would have to still participate in that barrage. It's not, if they decide they're not going to, then you can't use this. So whoever was originally in that shot has to still be in that I shouldn't say shot, but that artillery bombardment have to be in that ring, that one where you're doing all guns repeat. It's the same observer, it's the same guns, same platoons. Now, if you lose, let's say these got destroyed, and we still got, you know, a couple down here. Well, these two will still have to participate with them. It's if you lose guns, you can still do it. It's not that, oh, I had four, I've lost two, so I don't have four anymore, so I can't do it. It's not quite like that. If the platoon wants to use this, how many ever guns you have left, that's what you're going to shoot. And also, and I'll get to the templates in just a minute, you have to use the same template if you can. You can't then decide to use one that gives you rerolls. Now, if there's not enough teams to keep the bigger template, and again, I'll talk about the templates in just a minute. If there's not enough teams, like we've gone down, and so we're going to use a smaller template, you have to use the smaller template then. I mean, you got to use what you can use. So now we're going to select an aiming point. So we're going to pretend like this camera is our observer. So we're going to look down here. And really, selecting an aiming point is pretty much the same as shooting. Okay? A rifle, a tank shot, or anything like that. So to select an aiming point is basically, where do you want the artillery to come down onto? Who do you want to center this artillery bombardment on? Okay, so you choose your spotter, and I talk about who can observe, who can spot. So we got our observers, we got our staff team, we got the platoon commander, we've got any one of the guns that are participating in the artillery shot can spot, the company commander, higher command team, any one of those. And if you have the air observation post, that's another possibility. That's the airplane that can spot, and I'll get to that later. So, you then look at your, we're looking at this out here. Let's make sure I got everything. Yes, okay. So what we got is we got two Pac-40s, six Stugs, and a King Tiger. You get to pick. It's not like just roll dice and then the opponent allocates. It's not quite like that. There's really no, like, allocating in this. So you decide, I want to hit this one. No, I want to center on this. I want to center on this one. This one. No, I want to center on this. No, you know what? I want to center. You choose. King Tiger, center. Yeah. Which one do you want to center the template on? It's your choice as the attacker. So, but you still have to have that line of sight to the target. That's the most important thing. If you don't have line, if your observer doesn't have line of sight to the target, you can't pick that as your aiming point. Now, I'm going to zoom back out for just a minute because I want to discuss something. So we've got these guns here. And let's say they're behind this hill. Okay, this big, big hill. I'm just doing this for explanation purposes. And they're observers. Can you see? There we go. And there are observers up on top of this hill looking over. Okay? So these guys can't see the aiming point. But their observer up here can. It's not... The artillery pieces don't have to see the target to hit. Their observer, who's ever spotting, has to see the target. I really should have explained that earlier, but... So... As far as line of sight to these tanks or whoever you're going to shoot at, those artillery pieces don't have to be able to see them. It's who's ever, like, through this camera, this is our spotters looking here, that's who has to see them. Okay, so you have to have line of sight. You select a team. You can mark the team. So you might come and go, okay, I'm going to have it come down on this. It puts a marker on it, or you can just tell your opponent, I'm centering my template on this, my artillery blast on this guy. That's my aiming point. Just as long as your opponent knows what you're doing, you'll be fine. Now, next we need to check range. Now, the range is not from your observer. The range is from all those artillery pieces that are going to be shooting. And you check range just like... usual, front of the base to the nearest part of the enemy. And we have 88 inches to work with here, so I'm pretty sure we're okay. So, we got line of sight, checked range. There is one thing I need to bring this back in to these guys. These guys are lobbing shells at the bad guys that are going up, up, and then they're coming down on top. There is a minimum range for artillery bombardment, and that's 8 inches. So let me grab a bad guy. There's a bad guy. And they want to aim on this guy right here with their artillery bombardment. Well, anybody, any one of these within 8 inches can't do the artillery bombardment. So if we look, yep, this one is. Yep. This one's out and this one out. So if this platoon one do an artillery bombardment, these two are the only two that can shoot. Because they're further than 8 inches away from the target. So if they do artillery bombardment, they can't do anything. They cannot do any shooting. So there is a minimum range. And it's the same as mortars have that minimum range. It must be in your field of fire. So if that stuff was, remember, front, forward. So this actually had to rotate way over there. It was not in this field of fire. Can't do artillery bombardment. Because that rotation, because it's not in your field of fire, so you're going to have to rotate so it is. That's considered a move. And if you move, you can't do artillery bombardment. So it has to be in your field of fire. You do rotate to face who you're shooting. So if they're shooting at the aiming point. So you rotate to face the aiming point. Just like normal with the infantry or gun team, you rotate to face the target. Now, you can fire through. Normally, you know, you need that 1-inch gap to shoot between friendly teams. Well, with artillery bombardments, you're lobbing the shells, so you don't have to worry about who's in front of you. Now, there is a few rules, though, about what's in front of you that you can't shoot over. One of the things is... buildings. You're like, oh, wait, I can shoot over a building. Yeah, you can shoot over a building. But if we're looking at this building, in this artillery piece here, Can you shoot over this building? Can this one? And, excuse me. And what I mean is, it's got a line of sight, or its line of fire to the aiming point. It's going to go through this building. If it's shooting over here, well, its line of fire is not going through that building, so don't worry about it. It happens to be going through this building. How you can tell is, how tall is the building? It looks about 4 inches. How far away is it? It's only like 2 inches away. It has to be as far away as the building is tall. So it would have to be at least 4 inches away to be able to shoot over that building. If this building is this tall, it would have to be about maybe 5 inches away. You kind of can see that, there we go. It has to be about 5 inches away. So now he has to be even further back. So how tall the building is how far away that artillery has to be able to shoot. If their line of fire to the aiming points going through that building. Now mortars are a little different. They only have to be 4 inches away no matter how tall the building is. So if we look like at the church steeple over here, well, if you think about it, look how tall that steeple is. Think about how far the artillery would have to be away from that to shoot over that steeple. Well, mortar, 4 inches, it's okay. 4 inches away, it's fine. It can shoot over that. Another thing is forest. So I'm going to take the camera and take one of these gun teams. And we're going to go over and look at a forest. Hold on for just a second. Technical difficulties, there we go. Alright, so let's come over to this forest. There we go. Alright, so here we got a forest here. Whoops, as I'm knocking down the forest. Now, just like the mortars had to be 4 inches away from the woods, or from the building, everybody has to be at least 4 inches away from woods to be able to shoot over. If you're closer than 4 inches, you can't shoot over the woods. So you can't shoot, you can't do artillery bombardment this direction. You could that direction, because you're not going through the woods, you're going, you know. But if your line drawn to the aiming point goes through these woods, you better be at least 4 inches away. Now let's say this artillery piece is in the woods here, so it's at the edge. Like the tank's halfway in, halfway out, I talked about that. Same thing here. This can still do an artillery bombardment. You just can't do it that direction. Because it'll be shooting through the woods and it's closer to 4 inches, definitely. But it can do it this way. So it can do artillery bombardment this way. Now, it's in the woods. Just like the tank. Tank can't see beyond 6 inches. Well, this, when it's in the woods, cannot even do an artillery bombardment. Cannot do an artillery bombardment when you're in the woods. Yes, you can, except that direction. No, you can't. All right, so now I'm going to go take this back. There we go. All right, so I'm going to put the artillery piece back. There we go. So now we're going to get ready to range in. Let me get back here. All right, so we picked our target. Let's actually pick our target here. So, well, actually, we're not going to pick target. So this is our target platoon. We pick one team, so we could pick. Actually, there's more than one platoon here, but we pick one of these. So maybe this. Maybe that. We pick our aiming point. So how do we know if we are going to hit them? What we have to do first is what's called range in. So the spotter says, hey, they're at this coordinates here. Fire. Okay. Well, was he giving us good information or not? So what you do is you will take One die. And you will roll that one die.
And you're like, oh my gosh, that's horrible. At least with the tank, I can get 2 shots. Machine gun, 6. Heavy machine gun, I get 6. I get 1 die. Well, you get 3 attempts to range in. So you're almost like getting 3 dice. You don't want to roll 3 dice, though.
And you'll find out why. You roll 1 die, try, you roll again and try. If you fail, you roll a 3rd time and hope you get at least that time. So, what is our target number?
Well, just like shooting,
we need to find out what our target here is. And so, it's 2, 3, 4. Conscripts 2, train 3, veteran 4. So what are they? Well, we're going to keep it simple. We're going to go trained. So we need 3s to hit them. We have 3 chances to get a 3. That sounds great. Well, it may not be 3. Because just like shooting, we can shoot guns at these guys. But they may be concealed. They may be gone to ground and so forth. That's going to modify it. It's same modifiers. If they're concealed, it makes it 1 harder. If they're concealed and gone to ground, it makes it 2 harder. However, you don't have that 16 inches. Remember, if you're shooting a tank gun and it's over to 16 inches, it adds 1 to difficulty. You don't have that when you're spotting. So your spotter does not have that. I mean, distance does not matter. Can they see the target? Yes. All right, are they concealed or gone to ground? That is your modifiers. Now, if it is a mortar team shooting, and they're rolling and they fail their first attempt, they get to reroll that for free. So they actually have 4 chances if you think about it. But the first one is free, the reroll. Nobody else, you know, these artillery we're shooting, they're not going to get that reroll. Now, if you're successful, you can range in and fire the artillery bombardment. If you're unsuccessful, the artillery that shot that, they're done. Success or not, they're done that shooting step. It's just like if you missed with the tank. The tank's done. Okay, so we got our target. Let's see. If I choose this target, I'm looking at 3s. Well, this one's concealed. I'm looking at 4s. But it looks like I can possibly get more targets here than I can over there. So what do you do? Do I take 3s or do I take the 4s? I may take the 4 because I think I'm going to get more underneath it. Before we get to we're going to roll that, we're going to have to look at our templates. So I'm going to zoom this back for the templates to show you. There's 3 different sizes of templates that Flames of War uses for things like this artillery bombardment. And it depends upon how many guns are shooting the bad guys. So if you just have 1 gun doing artillery bombardment, you get to use... Ta-da! The artillery bombardment template. It's 6 inches by 6 inches square. And that's what you're going to use for your artillery bombardment. However, if you range in and you're using 1 gun to actually hit the targets, ranging in and hitting are 2 different things. You've ranged in, but you haven't hit them. It's 1 harder to hit the target. Not to range in, but to hit them. And if you do actually hit them, you have to reroll that successful hit 1 time to see if you actually did hit them. So 1 gun kind of really sucks. Okay, if you have 2 guns shooting this bombardment, you get the artillery bombardment template. No +1 to hit the enemy. But you still have to re-roll those successful hits. You just don't have enough guns yet to have effective saturation of the area. Next, if you have 3, 4, or 5 guns shooting this artillery bombardment, you get the artillery bombardment template. But there's no plus one and there's no rerolls, successful hits. Let's just use this and see if you hit them. Rerolls those hits. Okay, if you have 6 to 8 guns, you get the artillery bombardment template, and you get to reroll misses trying to hit them. Awesome. Or you can go with the double width template. Oh my gosh, look at that thing. Double width because it's double the width of these, so it's 1 foot by 6 inches. Oh my gosh, it's upside down. There we go. So it's 2 of these, so it's 1 foot by 6 inches. So if you are running 6 to 8, do you want to go with this one? Not as many targets going to be hit, but you get to reroll those misses. Or do you want to saturate an area, but you do not get to reroll those misses? You just take what you get. So you got choice. It's pretty nice. You get a choice. All right, 9 to 13 guns. What do you get? Oh, you get the double width template. And you get to reroll misses. That's awesome. Or the, I'm going to have to go way back here for this one, the devastating template, which is basically 4 of those smaller templates are 2 double widths. It's 12 inches by 12 inches. But there is no rerolls. So when it was like that 9 to 13, do you want to go with this one and get rerolls or just do this and get no rerolls? All right, last one. 14 or more gun shooting. You get the devastating template and you get to reroll misses. Pretty awesome. So that's our template size and it depends upon how many guns we are shooting. And for our demonstration purposes, we are shooting 4 guns. So that means we are getting the devastating template. Or not the devastating. We are getting the artillery. I'd like the devastating one. But we get the regular 6x6 artillery bombardment template. All right. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to move the camera over there. And we're going to see how this is going to all going to work. So here we go. Move this over here. Okay, that's the church. We're going to move this down to see the bad guys here. Now this is going to be, let me see if I can, I'm going to stop the camera and I'm going to try to get this set up for the template here. So I'll be right back. Okay, this is my aiming point. So I'm trying to hit this stug here that was concealed. So I need a 4. Remember, I have 3 attempts to get that 4. And it's very, very important you just don't pick up 3 dice and go, oh, I got it, 5. It doesn't work that way. It's not like a regular shot. You have to roll them separately. Just do it 1 at a time. So, first attempt, a 4. I was successful. So that's very important. It just took me 1 try. The next thing you do is you will take your template, you're going to center it on that tank, and see this little arrow? That's going to point towards the center of the artillery that's shooting. So my artillery wasn't straight that way, it was angled off that way. So center there, looking, and anybody under the template or partially under the template, and if you look, that one, probably not. So it looks like I got that one, yep. So I've got 1, 2, 3, 4 stugs underneath that template. This one was safe. Now, if we were shooting that way, look what would happen. Wow, 3. No, that's just 2 were under that template this time. So who's shooting and what you choose can really change how many you're going to get. I got 4, now 2. So There's my aiming point. Boom. I know I got four. So what I want to do is I'm going to put this here because that's how many times it took me to shoot. I'm going to take four dice because there's four targets underneath there. Now you see why you don't get a rate of fire. Depends on how many targets are underneath there as to how many dice you're going to roll to hit. All right. What's next? Okay, so you saw your target. You ranged in off of their skill level and then the modifiers of concealment and gone to ground. Did you use your company commander and so forth? We got in, ranged in. We found out how many was underneath the template. We rotated it. There's a little arrow here and we rotated so we were centered and saw how many we got. And it's completely under or even just partially. So as you see, this one's barely underneath it. Use the base of vehicles, not the gun. So if this was back here like this, it wouldn't be a target. So there you go. Now, what I need to hit depends upon my skill level. Well, we're just going to train with these, so it's a 4. 3, 4, 5. Start 3, 4, 5. So I'm trained, so I need a 4 to hit. Now, this is where if you have that one gun shooting, you add 1. So now it'd be 5s if I only had one gun shooting. That's the 2-hit roll, not the range in. Now, just for explanation purposes, if I rolled a 1, let's say I rolled a 1 to range in, then I rolled a 5. Woo, I ranged in on the second one. Because it took me a little bit longer to get ranged in, these guys got into cover better, it's going to make my 2-hit roll 1 harder because it took me 1 more time than what I needed to hit. So instead of needing 4s to hit, because I hit that first time, now I need 5s because I took the second try. Now, let's say this one, I rolled a 3. Oh, I failed a second. Oh. So I'm going to roll again, and I was finally successful on my third attempt. Well, that took 2 more times than what was needed, so you're going to have to add 2 to your 2-hit roll. So now, I'm going to need 6s to hit them. 4, 5, 6. And again, I start with 4 because they're trained. The teams that's shooting. To range in on them, it's their skill level. Then to hit them, it's my skill level plus the extras it took. But you know what? I was good. I rolled good. It took me 1 time. So I need 4s being trained. So I roll. And that one was cocked. Oh, I got 2 hits. Now, we talked about allocating hits. And, you know, gone to ground last and all that. There is some of that in this.